So we are very honored and pleased to welcome our Senate President and our very own Senator Stan Rosenberg, who is going to welcome State Auditor Suzanne Bum. Senator Rosenberg.
So good morning, everyone. Isn't this an amazing county? You know, Suzanne, you're from away, so you sat here and you listened to the amazing things that are going on in this place. Give yourselves a round of applause. You are the exemplar of what it means to be community, because you really think about your friends and neighbors, you think about what's needed in the community, you're building your businesses, but you're also helping to build a sense of community here. So thank you all for everything that you do. But my pleasure this morning is in introducing our guest speaker, Suzanne Bump. And I've known Auditor Bump for a while now. I knew her first as State Representative Bump from Braintree, Massachusetts. And she was a very effective state representative. And when she left the House of Representatives, she went on to do some stuff in the private sector, some advocacy, some counseling, and some legal stuff. She also did some public service. She was a member of the South Shore Chamber of Commerce, served on a number of nonprofit boards all over the place. And then Governor Patrick tapped her to be our Secretary of Labor and Workforce Development, where she did a really terrific job helping to modernize a lot of the parts of the training and education system to help employers get the employees that they needed into their places of operation with the kind of skills that they needed to grow and develop their businesses. And then she decided to run for state auditor. And I think the best way to describe her values in this is that she's totally committed to efficiency, transparency, and to making government fair and reasonable. And as part of her job, she has to dig deeply into the operations of various agencies and entities within government to determine if they're spending the taxpayers' dollars well and wisely. And when she inherited the office, it had actually just recently failed the standards of the National Auditors, the State Auditors Association, and a mere 3 years later, they are now ranked among the best and having met the highest standards of operations for state auditors' offices. So she really turned that organization around. So third-party validation is, I think, the best testament to the effectiveness that you've brought to that office. And so a very dedicated public servant, and it's my great pleasure to introduce to you our state auditor.
Thank you. I am delighted to be here. If I wasn't awake before I came to the podium, I really was awakened by all of the activity. I've never seen such vitality at a Chamber of Commerce event before. I commend you all for your commitment to one another and to your friends and neighbors. I want to thank you, Senate President Rosenberg, for that introduction. It's a great privilege to be able to serve with you in government again. As the Senate President alluded, he and I entered the House of Representatives just 2 years apart back in the 80s. So like many of you who are his constituents and his neighbors, I've had many years over which I could build my appreciation for his intellect and for his values. And I was being nosy a couple of days ago, and checked out his website to see what was going on. There's a quote on his website that I really think does a great job of summing up his attitude toward political leadership. He says, "The best way to win someone's trust is to tell the truth, clearly, forcefully, and directly." And there's one truth that's been very much on the minds of many of us inside and outside government recently, and it is that the scourge of addiction is taking so great a toll on our families, our healthcare system, and our community that we all have to change our behaviors and attitudes in order to stop it. Last week, there were some great strides that were taken when the governor signed into law legislation that began in the Senate. And I want to take this opportunity, Mr. President, to applaud you for your commitment to finding new strategies and for bringing new partners to the table to implement that. Thank you so much. And I do want to thank all of you for being here. Thank you, Anne, and the board and staff of the chamber for giving me the opportunity to talk to you a little bit about the work of my office and some of the innovative ways that we are bringing more accountability and transparency to state government. I also want to thank you, though, Bob. We had known one another a little bit when I was Secretary of Labor and Workforce Development, but you provided us with such vivid expressions of the values that you bring to your leadership of GCC. Not only could I see that bread, that dark rye bread, the pumpernickel bread being made, I could smell it. It was really great. So I enjoy opportunities like this, not just because they give me a chance to brag about what we're doing in the office, but because the conversations that I have with members of the community give me valuable insight into how you perceive the workings of our state government, and that helps direct my activities to be a driving force in making government work better, using those tools of transparency and accountability. It's frequently said, and maybe you've said it yourselves, that government should operate more like a business. How many times have you said that? And you know what? I'm a Democrat, and I agree with that statement. There are indeed more areas where practices should be in closer alignment. I see it particularly in our safeguarding of assets, our monitoring of operations, and in providing customer service. You guys and gals, you understand this. If you lose control over your inventory, you neglect to check on the new associate's work before it goes out to the client, you fail to keep your machinery in good repair, you're indifferent to your customer's needs, you will quickly be out of business. It is really fundamental. Well, this dynamic applies as well to the public sector. Now, the public sector entities don't typically go out of business, but when voters become disenchanted and they don't show up, or frankly, even worse this year, and I hate to go in this direction, or they vote for Ted Cruz or Donald Trump, then our democracy gets weakened. I'm a student. I'm a lawyer, and I'm a student of the public trust doctrine. And it goes back thousands of years, actually, to ancient Rome. It began as a rationale for setting aside certain navigable waterways and lands for public use. In Massachusetts, you'll recall, we organized as a commonwealth, founded under law for the common good. Today, we understand the concept of public trust is the idea that we have a shared interest in a wide variety of resources, resources like public safety and public education, a transportation network, a social safety net, and we are legitimately entitled to a set of expectations about how they're going to be used. But the public, as well we know, harbors a lot of mistrust of its government. And as I said, that is an attitude that really is being exploited by some of the candidates for public office this year in particular. I think that this is a problem that cannot be solved just with rhetoric. We need actions to solve this problem. And I believe that the key to rebuilding public trust is by investing in government accountability. If you think about the headlines, we don't really want to recall, but the headlines over the past couple of years about the Department of Children and Families, those stories of kids being lost, neglected, abused, and killed resulted in findings by my office and also by the Child Welfare League of America of serious resource and management deficiencies in this agency, chronic underfunding of the agency, a lack of social workers, a lack of managers, inadequate technology, and insufficient guidance as to how to most effectively respond to families in crisis. And in my view, it's this failure of government to effectively execute on core responsibilities, like keeping kids safe, much more than the occasional stories that we read about the misdeeds of a few in government, that truly demoralize the public and causes their loss of faith. It's the steady drip of accounts of chronic deficiencies in managing resources, projects, and programs, not just the occasional instance of individual wrongdoing, that erodes public confidence. So the Office of the State Auditor uses its audit authority, and I use opportunities like this to advance an agenda of government accountability. And let me give you a couple examples. Our audits of some of the state's public assistance programs a couple of years ago found that systemic failures to check eligibility of applicants was opening the door to fraud. Not checking, verifying social security numbers, not verifying statements of residence. All of those things allowed people who did not deserve the benefits to gain access to them. And although public assistance cheats represents a very small fraction of the total beneficiaries of these programs, it's enough to cause some people to say that we should eliminate the programs or make them so punitive that poor people won't want to use them. But the better response is not to shred that safety net, but to overhaul this agency's staffing and systems and put them in a stronger position to stop the fraud from occurring in the first place. In doing so, they can begin to rebuild the public's trust and confidence in this economically and morally important aspect of our Commonwealth. And we can keep the poor from being objects of scorn. In other recent audits, we've found things like the failure by the Mass DOT to allow an engineer to assess the current condition of a bridge that his company was supposed to repair at the start of the project, rather than relying on an estimate of a condition that was a couple of years old, resulted in extra millions of dollars of expense in years of delay in rebuilding the bridge. We found that judges haven't been following the rules when permitting a guilty person to do community service in lieu of serving a sentence, and we found that a single transportation company received $16 million for transporting patients in wheelchair vans when 95% of them were actually ambulatory and didn't need a wheelchair, let alone a wheelchair van. So accountability isn't just the idea that you should be willing to stand up and admit that your agency has failed. That's just an apology when you acknowledge that your agency has failed to do its job. Real accountability has to be a front-end function within government. It requires specific actions by the legislature and the governor and the program heads to ensure that we get the most out of our tax dollars by protecting them against fraud, waste, and abuse. It means developing and using new data to forecast needs and sticking to objectively identified priorities, even in the face of political pressure. It means staffing agencies with oversight professionals who read and act upon the reports that their systems generate. It means employing technologies that can reduce the risk of misspending. It means honest performance assessment. I've been a legislator, as you know. So has former State Representative Bill Benson. And the Senate President, we know that there's no glory to be gained by prioritizing spending on bureaucratic infrastructure. None at all. And there are politicians who base their entire campaigns on crusades to shrink the size of the bureaucracy. But I think we're all familiar with the expression, penny wise and pound foolish. Funding services without also funding sufficient administration and oversight is a classic example of the wisdom of this proverb. Now, if I'm going to preach this gospel, then my office has to lead by example. That's why, after the office failed its peer review, as the Senate President shared with you, my first mission in office was to make sure that we were actually auditing to government standards. But it's also motivated me to constantly develop new ways to more effectively use the resources in the auditor's office, because our budget is not escalating. We could always use additional funding, Mr. President. But we are doing actually more with less, because a few years ago, we began to augment our traditional auditing techniques with more advanced analytic tools. These tools allow us to take data from more than one source, integrate those different kinds of data sets in order to quickly identify patterns of behavior that stand out as potential sources of waste, fraud, and abuse. And we are now able to better utilize the talents and experience of our auditors on the areas in state government where there is the greatest risk of ineffective spending on poor service delivery. It used to be that we would just audit agencies in a rotation and we would find what we would find. Now, at the start of an audit, we know what we're going after. And because we don't have the resources to audit every agency in the three-year rotation that we are, frankly, supposed to, we are able to do risk-based auditing and put our resources to the best possible use. We're already seeing amazing success through these tools. And I want to talk just a bit about the Mass Health Program, because unlike other agencies, which we audit in some sort of a rotation, Mass Health, because it consumes 38%, you know this well, of the state budget, it makes it the state's single greatest expenditure. One in five, it moves back and forth a little bit, people in the Commonwealth are covered by the Mass Health Program. And it's a hugely complex program. It's more than just essentially an insurance program. It also has specialized services to specialized populations. There are lots of moving parts. There are, frankly, lots of things that can go wrong in the Mass Health Program. Well, we have day-to-day, nearly real-time access to all of the data in the Mass Health Program. We know who is receiving benefits. We know what their conditions are. We can see every claim, every transaction from prescription writing to doctor's visits to medical transportation that gets processed by this program. And the access that we have to the data allows us to quickly identify patterns that raise red flags and warrant additional investigation. Last year, for instance, we helped the program administrator realize that they weren't getting all of the benefits they could out of the managed care organizations into which more than half of the Mass Health members had been enrolled. They weren't achieving all of the cost savings and medical care potential that they could because for a variety of complex reasons, the agency, the program Mass Health, was still paying many of the medical bills that were supposed to be picked up by the managed care organizations. It amounted to hundreds of millions of dollars of poor administration and, in some cases, duplicate claims paying. A few weeks ago, our office released an audit of a medical provider just down the road in Springfield. We saw that he was billing at a much higher rate for certain services than all of the other providers in the state. And we discovered that what this guy was doing was engaging in a practice known as upcoding. He was marking as treatments for the much more complex treatments than he was actually providing. He was also charging the physician's rate for services that were being provided by nurses. Our audit recommendation, obviously, was to have him stop those practices, have him thrown out of the Mass Health program. It was also to recommended that the program recover over $200,000 in overbilling that the man had engaged in. That recommendation helped also encourage the man to retire from medical practice. But I hear though that he's going to go into the business of selling medical devices. So be very wary if anybody knocks on your door trying to sell you medical devices. So these tools enable us to collaborate with other state agencies to solve difficult problems in the Commonwealth. Let me just mention one other way that we're doing this. As I said at the outset, we have an opioid epidemic that's impacting every community in the Commonwealth. It's devastating families and it's cutting lives short. I know in Franklin County that the problem of addiction is compounded by a lack of access to adequate treatment facilities, so that rehab is actually hard to come by out here. Well, some years ago, I had helped to found a program that is running a women's recovery home in the city of Brockton. And I lobbied for several years on Beacon Hill as a member of its board to increase the rates that recovery homes were being paid by the state to support these services. So I'm no stranger to the problem of addiction. Additionally, my husband has been in a program to help him maintain his sobriety for more than 37 years. So when our leaders decided that they wanted to take action on this issue, I knew that I wanted to help. So I supported the legislative efforts. I testified before the relevant committees, but I wanted to do more. I wanted to put the resources of my office to work in this. And so I am now part of a working group of law enforcement officials and health officials trying to find a way to better identify the doctors who are over-prescribing. With our resources in the auditor's office, particularly through this access that I mentioned we have to Mass Health data, we can see who is prescribing opioids, but more importantly, we can see who is prescribing opioids on an unusually frequent basis to patients who live more than 75 miles away. That is a clear indication that this is not a legitimate medical practice, but rather that this doctor is running a pill mill. And so that's a tool that law enforcement doesn't have. They have been able to mostly get their leads from informers or by tracing back from an overdose victim. But we are helping put new tools in their hands so that we can shut these guys and gals down faster and put them away. So like many of our most persistent problems, the solutions to the opioid epidemic require an emphasis on addressing root causes and on collaboration from across state agencies. We have to break down the silos that prevent agencies and individuals from working together and forego the turf wars that often stall progress. We have to identify the skills and the strengths that we can each bring to the table and find ways to make them work for the Commonwealth. That's the only way we're going to comprehensively address the opioid crisis. So ultimately, whether it's conducting audits to identify mismanagement and security issues or using our unique talents and expertise to help other state agencies on the most important issues of the state, I believe my primary responsibility is to make government work better. It's a belief that I bring to the office every day and a belief that everyone on my team shares. And it's through this work that I hope to help build faith in state government. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk about the work of the office. And if we have time, I would love to take a question or two or any comments that you'd like to share. But again, thank you so much. It's been great.